We're going to open our meeting with a quiet time and follow it with the set-aside prayer. God, please help me set aside everything I think I know about myself, the 12 steps, the big book, the meetings, my disease, and you, God, so I may have an open mind and a new experience with all these things. Please let me see the truth. Amen. Thank you. The big book, or the book Alcoholics Anonymous, that's nicknamed the Big Book, was first published in April 1939. Now, back then, we were a society of readers. Radios were still new, and if you wanted to see a movie, you had to go to your local theater. Now, of course, we have many kinds of home and portable entertainment available. Consequently, many of us don't read as much as we used to, so we can't expect everyone who comes to AA to read our book without some prompting, like maybe poke them with a sharp stick. But today, we're going to read a lot from our basic text. Reading the Big Book is the only way to learn from it. We hope that today's experience will encourage you to visit these pages often. You might want to think of the Big Book as your best friend. We're going to start by reading the foreword to the first edition at the top of Roman numeral page 13, XIII. It's the first paragraph.
Forward to the first edition. Yeah. It's forward to the first edition, first page. It says, "We of Alcoholics Anonymous are more than 100 men and women who have recovered from a seemingly hopeless state of mind and body. To show other alcoholics precisely how we have recovered is the main purpose of this book. For them, we hope that these pages will prove so convincing that no further authentication will be necessary."
So the Big Book authors immediately tell us that the main purpose of this book is to show others precisely how we have recovered from alcoholism. Precisely means no variation or deviation. No room for opinion here. Now, this is a revolutionary statement because before the Big Book was written, there was no hope for alcoholics. Now, anyone who is willing to follow the directions they have provided can recover. Now, we're going to read the original preamble as it appeared back then, and this starts with the last line of the same page.
"We are not an organization in the conventional sense of the word. There are no fees or dues whatsoever. The only requirement for membership is an honest desire to stop drinking. We are not allied with any particular faith, sect, or denomination, nor do we oppose anyone. We simply wish to be helpful to those who are afflicted."
Okay, let's begin our spiritual journey. Step one.
"We admitted we were powerless over alcohol and that our lives had become unmanageable."
Surrender is essential in order to recover from alcoholism. The Big Book authors devote 51 pages of the book to the first part of the surrender process, which is to admit that we have a problem. Before we can do this, we need to define what an alcoholic is. Now, much of the doctor's opinion is based on two letters written by Dr. William Silkworth, who had been a physician at Towns Hospital in New York City. He had been treating alcoholics for years with very little success, until a miraculous fellowship was born. In the late 1930s, very little was known about alcoholism, but much of what the doctor wrote then is still relevant today.
Go to page XXIII in the third paragraph, XXIII, third paragraph, and it starts with, "In late 1934.
He describes how Bill W. recovered from alcoholism. Bill had once been a well-respected Wall Street stock analyst, but he eventually lost everything because of his drinking.
It says, it's the letter we're going to read. In late 1934, I attended a patient who, though had been a competent businessman of good earning capacity, was an alcoholic of type I come to regard as hopeless. In the course of his third treatment, he acquired certain ideas concerning a possible means of recovery. As part of his rehabilitation, he commenced to present his conceptions to other alcoholics, impressing upon them that they must do likewise with still others. This has become the basis of a rapidly growing fellowship of these men and their families. This man and over 100 others appear to have recovered. I personally know scores of cases who were of this type with whom other methods had failed completely.
Then during his third trip to the hospital, Bill is told that alcoholism is a physical and a mental illness. Dr. Silkworth explains this to us now in the second paragraph on the following page.
Turn the page to XXIV, XXIV, first paragraph.
The physician who, at our request, gave us this letter has been kind enough to enlarge upon his views in another statement which follows. In this statement, he confirms that we who have suffered alcoholic torture must believe that the body of the alcoholic is quite as abnormal as the mind. It did not satisfy us to be told that we could not control our drinking just because we were maladjusted in life, that we were in full flight from reality, or were outright mental defectives. These things were to some extent, in fact to a considerable extent, with some of us, but we are sure that our bodies were sickened as well. In our belief, any picture of the alcoholic which leaves out this physical factor is incomplete.
I always thought it would be amusing to have a t-shirt that says outright mental defective on it. Maybe the other side saying, in full flight from reality. Another way we can find each other, huh? Okay.
I'm going to read the next paragraph. It says, the doctor's theory that we have an allergy to alcohol interests us. As laymen, our opinion as to its soundness may, of course, mean little. But as ex-problem drinkers, we can say that this explanation makes good sense. It explains many things for which we cannot otherwise account.
Now let's look at this abnormal physical response to alcohol. Alcohol is a poison. The normal reaction to alcohol is to have one or two drinks and stop. But the alcoholic reaction is much different, obviously. We have one or two drinks just to get started. Can anyone relate to that? Yeah. Okay, so we have an abnormal reaction to alcohol. Now, Dr. Silkworth tells us that the average temperate drinker, a normal person, does not crave alcohol.
Go to page XXVI, XXVI, first paragraph.
It's the first paragraph. It says, we believe, and so suggested a few years ago, that the action of alcohol on these chronic alcoholics is a manifestation of an allergy, that the phenomenon of craving is limited to this class and never occurs in the average temperate drinker. These allergic types can never safely use alcohol in any form at all, and once having formed a habit and found they cannot break it, once having lost their self-confidence, their reliance upon things human, and their problems pile up upon them and become astonishingly difficult to solve.
So we have a physical allergy to alcohol and a craving for alcohol once we start drinking. This craving never occurs in the average temperate drinker. Normal people don't crave alcohol, and they don't have an obsession with it. Now, please keep in mind that Dr. Silkworth now is talking about alcoholics when he writes this in the last paragraph on the same page.
Oh, yeah. It says, men and women drink essentially because they like the effect produced by alcohol. The sensation is so elusive that while they admit it is injurious, they cannot after a time differentiate the true from the false. To them, their alcoholic life seems the only normal one. They are restless, irritable, and discontented unless they can again experience a sense of ease and comfort which comes at once by taking a few drinks, which they seem others taken with impunity. After they had succumbed to the desire again, as so many do, the phenomenon of craving develops, and they pass through well-known stages of esprit, emerging remorseful with a firm resolution not to drink again. This is repeated over and over. Unless this person can experience an entire psychic change, there is very little hope of his recovery.
We learn more about this phenomenon of craving in the last paragraph on the same page.
It says, I do not hold with those who believe that alcoholism is entirely a problem of mental control. I have had many men who had, for example, worked a period of months on some problem or business deal, which was to be settled on a certain date favorable to them. They took a drink a day or so prior to the date, and then the phenomenon of craving at once became paramount to all other interests, so that the important appointment was not met. These men were not drinking to escape. They were drinking to overcome a craving beyond their mental control. There are many situations which arise out of the phenomenon of craving which cause men to make supreme sacrifice rather than continue to fight.
Which means they drink again. Now move down 4 paragraphs and we'll read more about this craving.
All these and many others have one symptom in common. They cannot start drinking without developing the phenomenon of craving. This phenomenon, as we have suggested, may be a manifestation of an allergy which differentiates these people and sets them apart as a distinct entity. It has never been, by any treatment with which we are familiar, permanently eradicated. The only relief we have to suggest is entire abstinence.
When I first went to a counselor and she suggested complete abstinence, I said to her, I thought that was rather extreme. So once we start to drink, we have a craving beyond our mental control. Our only relief is to not pick up the first drink. Let's go now to regular page 3 in chapter 1, starting with the second paragraph. We're going to read parts of Bill's story to help you identify with the progressive nature of alcoholism. That's regular page 3, chapter 1, the second paragraph.
It said, my drinking assumed more serious proportions, continuing all day and almost every night. The remonstrances of my friends terminated in a row, and I became a lone wolf. There was many unhappy scenes in our sumptuous apartment.
On page 5, paragraph 1, Bill writes,
and we're just going to read that one line on that page. It says, liquor ceased to be a luxury, it became a necessity.
So he crossed what we call that invisible line. Now drop down 8 lines.
Starts off with, nevertheless, I still thought I could control the situation, and there were periods of sobriety which renewed my wife's hope. Gradually, things got worse.
Okay, please skip down a paragraph and read now about how frightened Bill was becoming.
I woke up. This had to be stopped. I saw I could not take so much as one drink. I was through forever. Before then, I had written lots of sweet promises, but my wife happily observed this time I meant business, so I did. Shortly afterward, I came home drunk. There had been no fight. What had been my high resolve? I simply didn't know. It hadn't even crossed my mind. Someone had pushed a drink my way. I had taken it. Was I crazy? I began to wonder, for such an appalling lack of perspective seemed near being just that. Renewing my resolve, I tried again. Some time passed. Confidence began to be replaced with cocksureness. I could laugh at the gin mills. Now I had what it takes. One day I walked into a cafe to telephone. In no time I was beating on the bar, asking myself how it happened. As the whiskey rose to my head, I told myself I would manage better next time, but I might as well get good and drunk then, and I did. The remorse, horror, and hopelessness of the next morning are unforgettable. The courage to do battle was not there. My brain raced uncontrollably, and there was a terrible sense of impending calamity.
Now go to the next paragraph.
The mind and body are marvelous mechanisms. For mind endured this agony 2 more years.
Let's go down 2 paragraphs, and we're going to learn about 3 different types of drinkers. Oops. Wrong page. Oops, yeah. On the next page, count 3 lines down from the top. They stuck together.
3 lines down from the top of the page, it says, people feared for my sanity, so did I. It's the 3rd line down on page 7.
Now go to the 2nd paragraph.
It relieved me somewhat to learn that in alcoholics, the will is amazingly weakened when it comes to combating liquor, though it often remains strong in other respects. My incredible behavior in the face of a desperate desire to stop was explained. Understanding myself now, I fared forth in high hope. For 3 or 4 months, the goose hung high. I went to town regularly, and even made a little money. Surely this was the answer, self-knowledge. But it was not, for the frightful day came when I drank once more. The curve of my declining morale and bodily health fell off like a ski jump. After a time, I returned to the hospital.
Okay, things are progressing quickly now. Now, in the 1st paragraph on page 8, Bill loses all hope. First paragraph.
No words can tell the loneliness and despair I found in the bitter morass of self-pity. Quicksand stretched around me in all directions. I had met my match. I had been overwhelmed. Alcohol was my master.
Can anyone identify with the... Oops. Oh, yeah. All right. He's stopping me again. We do this on occasion. All right. I know that every time I read this, I feel... I get that feeling all over again, that horrible, terrible feeling that I felt when I first came in here, where I was afraid to live and I was afraid to die. I just didn't know which way to turn. Can anybody else identify then with the progression and hopelessness of Bill's alcoholism? Let's see, oh, okay, yeah, good. Now we're gonna continue with Bill's story a little bit later. We're gonna go into chapter 2, There Is a Solution, starting on page 17. Now here we're given some hope. We're going from feeling hopeless, we want to get some hope. And we're going to find that in the first paragraph on page 17.
It says, we of Alcoholics Anonymous know thousands of men and women who were once just as hopeless as Bill. Nearly all have recovered. They have solved the drink problem.
On the next page, the authors tell us how alcoholism destroys our lives and harms all those whose lives we touch. You know, people talk about, I wasn't hurting anybody but myself. Well, that's rubbish.
It says, an illness of this sort, we have come to believe that an illness involves those about us in a way no human sickness can. If a person has cancer, all are sorry for him and no one is angry or hurt, but not so with the alcoholic illness. For with it goes annihilation of all things worthwhile in life. It engulfs all those lives touched the sufferers. It brings misunderstanding, fierce resentment, financial insecurity, disgusted friends and employers, warped lives of blameless children, sad wives and parents. Anyone can increase the list. We hope this volume will inform and comfort those who are or who may be affected. There are many.
Please skip down to the fourth paragraph. Here the authors use squiggly writing to let us know it's really important. Every time we see that squiggly writing, pay attention.
It says, but the ex-problem drinker who has found the solution, who is properly armed with facts about himself, can generally win the entire confidence of another alcoholic in a few hours. Until such an understanding is reached, little or nothing can be accomplished.
Starting with the first paragraph on page 20, we're given the purpose of this book.
First paragraph, page 20. You may already have asked yourself, why is it that all of us become so very ill from drinking? Doubtless you are curious to discover how and why, in the face of expert opinion to the contrary, we have recovered from a hopeless condition of mind and body. If you are an alcoholic who wants to get over it, you may already be asking, what do I have to do? It is the purpose of this book to answer such questions specifically.
Let's go down two paragraphs, and there we find we're going to learn about the three different types of drinkers. Now we're going to learn about them. Okay.
It says...
We're going to go to two paragraphs down and learn about the three different types of alcoholics. Two different types of drinkers, I mean.
Page 20.
It's page 20.
Starts off with the moderate drinker. Moderate drinkers have little trouble in giving up liquor entirely if they had good reason for it. They can take it or leave it alone. Then we have a certain type of hard drinker who may have the habit badly enough to gradually impair him physically and mentally and may cause him to die a few years before his time. If a sufficient strong reason, ill health, falling in love, change of environment, or a warning of a doctor becomes operative, this man can also stop or moderate, although he may find it difficult and troublesome, may even need medical attention. But what about the real alcoholic? He may start off as a moderate drinker. He may or may not become a continuous hard drinker. But at some stage of his drinking career, he begins to lose all control of his liquor consumption once he starts to drink.
So the question is, what happens to the real alcoholic after he takes the first drink? Anybody know?
Another drink,
that's it. More and more. Okay, in the last paragraph on the bottom of page 22, we learn where the main problem of the alcoholic centers.
We know that while the alcoholic keeps away from drink, as he may do for months or years, he reacts much like other men. We are equally positive that once he takes any alcohol, whatever, into his system, something happens both in the bodily and mental sense which makes it virtually impossible for him to stop. The experience of any alcoholic will abundantly confirm this. These observations would be academic and pointless if our friend never took the first drink, thereby setting the cycle in motion. Therefore, the main problem of the alcoholic centers in his mind rather than his body. If you ask him why he started on the last bender, the chances are he will offer you any one of 100 alibis.
Next, we learn more about the mental obsession in the following paragraph.
Once in a while, he may tell the truth. And the truth, strange to say, is usually he has no more idea why he took the first drink than you have. Some drinkers have excuses with which they are satisfied part of the time, but in their hearts, they really do not know why they do that. Once this malady has a real hold, they are baffled a lot. There is an obsession that somehow, someday, they will beat the game, but they often suspect that they are down for the count. How true this is, few realize in a vague way their families and friends sense that these drinkers are abnormal. But everybody hopefully awaits the day when the sufferer arouses himself from his lethargy and exerts his willpower. The tragic truth is that if the man be a real alcoholic, the happy day may not arrive. He has lost control. At a certain point in the drinking of every alcoholic, he passes into a state where the most powerful desire to stop drinking is of absolutely no avail. The tragic situation has already arrived in practically every case long before it is suspected. Now we're going to go to the squiggly writing. The fact is that most alcoholics, for reasons yet obscured, have lost the power of choice in drink. Our so-called willpower becomes practically non-existent. We are unable at certain times to bring into our consciousness with sufficient force the memory of suffering and humiliation of even a week or a month ago. We are without defense against the first drink.
Okay, there's that squiggly writing. Let's read that last line again. It's very important.
We are without defense against that first drink.
Now let's continue down the page.
The almost certain consequences that follow taking even a glass of beer do not crowd into the mind to deter us. If these thoughts occur, they are hazily and readily supplanted with the old threadbare idea that this time we shall handle ourselves like other people. There is a complete failure of a kind of defense that keeps one from putting his hand on a hot stove. The alcoholic may say to himself in the most casual way, "It won't hurt me this time, so here's how." Or perhaps he doesn't think at all. How often have some of us begun to drink in this nonchalant way, and after the third or fourth, pounded on the bar and said to ourselves, "For God's sakes, how did I ever get started again?" Only to have that thought supplanted by, "Well, I'll stop with the sixth drink, or what's the use anyhow?" When this sort of thinking is fully established in an individual with alcoholic tendencies, he has probably placed himself beyond human aid, and unless locked up, may die or go permanently insane. These stark and ugly facts have been confirmed by legions of alcoholics throughout history.
There's some very harsh words there. May die or permanently go insane. Now on page 30, six pages forward, in paragraph 1, we read about how we will never again control our drinking. Page 30, paragraph 1.
Most of us have been unwilling to admit we were real alcoholics. No person likes to think he is bodily and mentally different from his fellows. Therefore, it is not surprising that our drinking careers have been characterized by countless vain attempts to prove we could drink like other people. The idea that somehow, someday, he will control and enjoy his drinking is the great obsession of every abnormal drinker. The persistence of this delusion is astonishing. Many pursue it into the gates of insanity or death.
Now skip down one paragraph.
We alcoholics are men and women who have lost the ability to control our drinking. We know that no real alcoholic ever recovers control. All of us felt at times we were regaining control, but such intervals, usually brief, were inevitably followed by still less control, which led in time to pitiful and incomprehensible demoralization. We are convinced to a man that alcoholics of our type are in the grip of progressive illness. Over any considerable period, we get worse, never better.
In the next paragraph, we're told that we can never become normal drinkers once we have lost control. Once a pickle, always a pickle. No matter how hard I try, I can never be a cucumber again.
We are like men who lost their legs. They never grow new ones. Neither does there appear to be any kind of treatment which will make alcoholics of our kind like other men. We have tried every imaginable remedy. In some instances, there was brief recovery, followed always by still worse relapse. Physicians who are familiar with alcoholism agree there is no such thing as making a normal drinker out of an alcoholic.
The authors clearly state that relapse is not part of the recovery program. Now let's read the next paragraph.
Despite all we can say, many who are real alcoholics are not going to believe that they are in this class. By every form of self-deception and experimentation, they will try to prove themselves exception to the rule, therefore non-alcoholic. If anyone who is showing inability to control his drinking can do the right about face and drink like a gentleman, our hats go off to him. Heaven knows we have tried hard enough and long enough to drink like other people.
That one's ours, right? In the first paragraph on page 33, two pages up, starting at the end of the first line, again we are told that we must have no reservations.
Most of us believe that if we remain sober for a long stretch, we could therefore drink normally. But here is a man who at 55 years found he was just where he left off at 30. We have seen the truth demonstrated again and again. Once an alcoholic, always an alcoholic. Commencing to drink after a period of sobriety, we are in a short time as bad as ever. If we are planning to stop drinking, there must be no reservation of any kind. No lurking notion that someday we will be immune to alcohol. And I just, you know, we added this paragraph in, and I just want to say that my father went out and relapsed last year after having 27 years of sobriety. And the first thing that he said was that it was worse. It was like he never stopped drinking. He picked up right where he left off, and he drank for 2 weeks, and he spent 7 days in detoxing. And the neighbors found him wandering around, you know, the neighborhood. And so I needed to see that and hear that. That it was right where he left off. He picked up just where he left off. I'm not sure if he is sober today or not. I know a couple of times I had called him and he was drunk, and then a couple of times I called him, he wasn't. But I know that, you know, we tried to take him to a meeting and he just didn't want to go and all that. Just didn't want anything to do with it, you know. So, you know, commencing to drink after a period of sobriety, we were in short time worse than ever.
It's interesting, he didn't want anyone to recognize him at meetings, but he was wandering around the neighborhood drunk and all beat up from falling down. Sound a little familiar to any of us here? Okay, now we're going to go to the next page, on page 34. And here in the second paragraph, we're told that even though we have the desire to stop drinking, we found it impossible to stop. Once an alcoholic, always an alcoholic.
For those who are unable to drink moderately, the question is how to stop altogether. We are assuming, of course, the reader desires to stop. Whether such a person can quit upon a non-spiritual basis depends upon the extent to which he has already lost the power to choose whether he will drink or not. Many of us felt we had plenty of character. There was a tremendous urge to cease forever, yet we found it impossible. This is the baffling feature of alcoholism as we know it, the utter inability to leave it alone, no matter how great the necessity or the wish.
So this is one of the ways we can determine whether we are real alcoholics or not. If we want to leave it alone and we can't, and once we start we have no control over how much we drink, we are probably alcoholic.
Next paragraph. How then shall we help our readers determine to their own satisfaction whether they are one of us? The experiment of quitting for a period of time will be helpful, but we think we can render an even greater service to alcoholic sufferers and perhaps to the medical fraternity. So we shall describe some of the mental states that precede a relapse into drinking, for obviously this is the crux of the problem. What sort of thinking dominates an alcoholic who repeats time after time the desperate experiment of the first drink? Friends who have reasoned with him after a spree which brought him to the point of divorce or bankruptcy are mystified when he walks directly into a saloon. Why does he Of what is he thinking?
Of what are we thinking? This is where the problem lies, is in our thinking. Now, in the first paragraph on page 37, the authors define this type of thinking.
It says, whatever the precise definition of the word may be, we call this plain insanity. How can such a lack of proportion or the ability to think straight be called anything else?
Okay, so we're told that we have insane thinking. Now, keep in mind that they also say that insanity is when you do the same thing over and over again, expecting different results. Okay, now on the next page, page 38, in the second paragraph, count four lines down. Now here we're told that self-knowledge is of no use to us. This is the next page, 38, in the second paragraph, count four lines down in the second paragraph.
Remember in Bill's story where he said, I think I got the answer, self-knowledge. And now they're going to remind us of that. And so it says, however intelligent we may have been with other respects, where alcohol has been involved, we have been strangely insane. It's strong language, but isn't it true? Some of you are thinking, yes, what you have told us is true, but it doesn't fully apply. We admit we have some of the symptoms, but we have not gone down to the extremes you fellows did, nor are we likely to, for we understand ourselves so well that after what we have told us, that such things cannot happen again. We have not lost everything in life through drinking, and certainly don't intend to. Thanks for the information. That may be true for certain non-alcoholic people who, though drinking foolishly and heavily at present time, are able to stop or moderate because their brains and bodies have not been damaged as ours were. But for the actual or potential alcoholic, with hardly an exception, will be absolutely unable to stop drinking on the basis of self-knowledge. See that squiggly writing? Unable, absolutely unable to stop drinking on the basis of self-knowledge. This is the point we wish to emphasize and re-emphasize to smash home upon our alcoholic readers as it has been revealed to us out of our bitter experience.
So the actual alcoholic, the real alcoholic, has been damaged in mind and body. There are other people that are able to moderate or stop that haven't been damaged like we have. Now, let's have a quick review. We have a physical allergy to alcohol. We are allergic to it. We have an abnormal reaction to alcohol. We crave it once we start drinking. Then we have a mental obsession, which tells us that taking another drink is the only solution when we're restless, irritable, and discontent. Then once we start to drink, we develop the phenomenon of craving, and the cycle starts all over again. Now, first we obsess about alcohol. Then we relieve the obsession by taking a drink. That first drink sets off an allergic reaction, and that has us crave more. So we drink again. However, just knowing this about ourselves is not enough to help us stop drinking. Now let's turn to page 44. This is a really important page. If you're not sure whether you're alcoholic or someone you know may not be sure, you don't have to answer 20 questions. You just look at this page here. There's two questions. It's five pages forward. Page 44, and we're going to read the first paragraph. Here we ask ourselves only two questions to decide whether we are alcoholic or not.
It says, in the preceding chapters, you have learned something of alcoholism. We hope we've made a clear distinction between alcoholic and non-alcoholic.
Number one.
If when you honestly want to, you find you cannot quit entirely.
Number two.
Or if when drinking you have little control over the amount you take, you are probably alcoholic.
Now that we made a clear distinction between the alcoholic and non-alcoholic, let's look at the second half of step one, the unmanageability that comes with alcoholism. Please turn up to page 52 now. Page 52, we're going to go to the third line in the second paragraph. Page 52, third line in the second paragraph.
It starts off, it says, we were having trouble. Did everybody find that? We were having trouble with personal relationships. We couldn't control our emotional nature. We were a prey of misery and depression. We couldn't make a living. We had a feeling of uselessness. We were full of fear. We were unhappy. We couldn't seem to be real help to other people.
When I check these areas of my life, I can see where my life is unmanageable. This is without using the program. I may be in a member of the fellowship, but if I'm not using it, I can see how this shows where my life is unmanageable. Left to my own devices, I create problems in my life, and my life becomes unmanageable. Some people call this untreated alcoholism, so we can have this in or outside the rooms of AA. Now, please try to identify with what we read here so that you can see your own unmanageability with your own disease. Please turn back to page 30. Sorry, this wasn't written in order, you know, but this is the best we can do. All right, back to page 30 in the second paragraph. Here we're told what we have to do for step one.
It says, we learned that we had to fully concede to our innermost selves that we were alcoholics. This is the first step in recovery. The delusion that we are like other people, or present it may be, has to be smashed.
In order to smash the delusion that you're not alcoholic, we're going to ask each of you to answer a simple question. Are you ready to concede to your innermost self that you are powerless over alcohol? In other words, are you an alcoholic? All that is required is a simple yes or no. Now, maybe you don't believe that you're an alcoholic. Maybe you think you're here by mistake. We just want you to know we'd rather be inside the fellowship of Alcoholics Anonymous by mistake than outside the fellowship drinking and dying by mistake. It's something to think about. Now, will those who are ready to take the first step please stand? We're going to stand up and we're going to do this. I want to try to make eye contact with each person, so I'm going to do it by table, you know, table by table. And I'm going to ask the question, and simply you can just answer yes or no and then be seated. And I'll ask the next person and go around the table till we've gone through the room. Now, here is our first step question. Do you concede to your innermost self that you are alcoholic? I'm going to start on my left.
Yes.
Okay, here? Okay, thank you. Good. Thank you. Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Here? Okay. All right, we'll do here.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yes.
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 All right.
Yes.
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 Thank you. Congratulations. According to the Big Book authors, those who've answered yes to this question have taken step one. You've now started on the path to recovery. Please give yourself a hand. Now, we learn by asking questions, so no question pertaining to recovery is silly or irrelevant. Did anybody take some notes or some questions they'd like to ask?